Well, good morning and welcome to another edition of Daily Scripture with Pastor Dave. I am David Morgan, pastor at Bear Swamp Baptist Church, and I just want to welcome you into this beautiful Thursday morning where we're going to have the pleasure of reading from the book of Job. Let me show you what we're reading today. Book of Job, chapters 4 through 7, the book of Psalm, chapter 99, and Revelation, chapter 11. Sorry we got started a little bit late. I actually started a video a couple of minutes ago, and then about 5 minutes into it, I realized my mic was turned off. So I just deleted that video, and I'm starting over. Before I begin, I want to give the correct attribution where it belongs. Today's music comes from this CD. It's called Joy to the World. Here, I'll let you get a bigger look at that. Is from the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. I used to have a different CD. It was the same CD in a different cover. I don't like this cover as much. I mean, I have nothing against Santa Claus, but he's not really what Christmas is about. But anyway, that's the CD I have now. But that's where the music's coming from. So if you're interested in that, you can find that online. Just search Joy to the World, Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. I've enjoyed this music for about 13 years now, and I listen to it every single year, and I hope you will enjoy it as I'm reading today. So once again, Job 4 through 7, Psalm 99, and then Revelation chapter 11. So in the book of Job, chapters 1 and 2, Job is tested by Satan. He loses everything. Chapter 3, he doesn't curse God. He keeps his integrity. He does not curse God, but he does curse the day he was born. And I don't know that he was fully embracing 1 Thessalonians 5:18 at the time, and everything give thanks. But hey, if you lost everything, that would be hard to do, wouldn't it? So let's get right into this reading. Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered and said, "If one ventures a word with you, will you be impatient? Yet who can keep from speaking? Behold, you have instructed many, and you have strengthened the weak hands." Excuse me, just 1 second. I'm thinking the music might be a little loud. Let me just go down a little bit on that. Your words have upheld him who was stumbling, and you have made firm the feeble knees. But now it has come to you, and you are impatient. It touches you, and you are dismayed. He says, are you going to listen to the advice you give other people? It's like marriage advice is easy to give until it's your marriage. Child-rearing advice is easy to give until it's your children. This is why we turn to the Word of God. Is not your fear of God your confidence and the integrity of your ways your hope? Remember, who that was innocent ever perished? He's saying, If you're in trouble, you know, you're not innocent, Job. Or where were the upright cut off? As I have seen, those who plow iniquity and sow trouble reap the same. By the breath of God they perish, and by the blast of his anger they are consumed. The roar of the lion, the voice of the fierce lion, the teeth of the young lions are broken. The strong lion perishes for lack of prey, and the cubs of the lioness are scattered. Now a word was brought to me stealthily. My ear received the whisper of it. It's going too far. Amid thoughts from visions of the night, when deep sleep falls on men, dread came upon me and trembling, which made all my bones shake. A spirit glided past my face. The hair of my flesh stood up. You know what's interesting? Excuse me. I have to plug my Mac in. I'll go to a different scene real quick. You don't have to watch me do all this. Wow, that was close. I almost ran out of battery there. Eliphaz is saying he saw a vision of an angel while he was asleep, and that vision was scary to him. He says, "The hair of my flesh stood up. It stood still, but I could not discern its appearance. A form was before my eyes. There was silence. Then I heard a voice. Can mortal man be in the right before God? Can a man be pure before his maker? Even in his servants he puts no trust, and his angels he charges with error. How much more those who dwell in houses of clay, whose foundation is in the dust, who are crushed like the moth." He's saying this is all what that person said, this angelic being. By the way, you know, if what I said yesterday is true, and Job lived in the time of Abraham or even before Abraham, you know, God did reveal himself more often to people in visions and in dreams back then than he does today, because today we have his completed word. They didn't have that. And so perhaps Eliphaz is telling the truth here. Perhaps he actually did see this vision and hear these words, but he's not interpreting them correctly. He is correct that God holds everyone guilty, but he's wrong to charge Job the way he is. Between morning and evening, they are beaten to pieces. They perish forever without anyone regarding it. Is not their tent cord plucked up within them? Do they not die, and that without wisdom? He's basically saying only the wicked are punished. Only the wicked suffer, and that's just not true. We see examples all throughout Scripture of even the righteous suffering. Call now, chapter 5. Is there anyone who will answer you? To which of the holy ones will you turn? Surely vexation kills the fool, and jealousy slays the simple. I have seen the fool taking root, but suddenly I cursed his dwelling. His children are far from safety. They are crushed in the gate, and there is no one to deliver them. The hungry eat his harvest, and he takes it out, even out of thorns, and the thirsty pant after his wealth. For affliction does not come from the dust, nor does trouble sprout from the ground, but man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward. As for me, I would seek God, and to God would I commit my cause, who does great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number. He gives rain on the earth and sends water on the fields. He sets on high those who are lowly, and those who mourn are lifted to safety. He frustrates the devices of the crafty, so that their hands achieve no success. He catches the wise in their own craftiness, and the schemes of the wily are brought to a quick end. See, all of this is true, but he's charging Job with being wily. He's charging Job with being crafty, and that's where he's wrong. They meet with darkness in the daytime and grope at noonday as in the night. But he saves the needy from the sword of their mouth and from the hand of the mighty. So the poor have hope, and injustice shuts her mouth. Behold, blessed is the one whom God reproves. Therefore despise not the discipline of the Almighty. For he wounds, but he binds up. Boy, that is true. That is absolutely true. Eliphaz is not wrong. He will deliver you from six troubles, and seven no evil shall touch you. In famine he will redeem you from death, and in war from the power of the sword. You shall be hidden from the lash of the tongue, and shall not fear destruction when it comes. At destruction and famine you shall laugh, and shall not fear the beasts of the earth. For you shall be in league with the stones of the field, and the beasts of the field shall be at peace with you. You shall know that your tent is at peace, and you shall inspect your fold and miss nothing. You shall know that your offspring shall be many. That had to hurt, knowing that Job's children just died, and your descendants as the grass of the earth. He shouldn't have said that. That was, you know how we say, too soon? That's too soon, Eliphaz. You shall come to your grave in ripe old age, like a sheaf gathered up in its season. Behold, this we have searched out. It is true. Hear and know it for your good. Let's see what Job says. Then Job answered and said, "Oh, that my vexation were weighed, and all my calamity laid in the balances, for then it would be heavier than the sand of the sea. Therefore my words have been rash. For the arrows of the Almighty are in me. My spirit drinks their poison. The terrors of God are arrayed against me. Does the wild donkey bray when he has grass, or the ox low over his fodder? Can that which is tasteless be eaten without salt? Or is there any taste in the juice of the mallow? My appetite refuses to touch them. They are as food that is loathsome to me. Oh, that I might have my request, and that God would fulfill my hope, that it would please God to crush me, that he would let loose his hand and cut me off. He just wants to die. He says it again. This would be my comfort. I would even exult in pain, unsparing. For I have not denied the words of the Holy One. What is my strength that I should wait? And what is my end that I should be patient? Is my strength the strength of stones? Or is my flesh bronze? Who is it that said, if you cut me, do I not bleed? I forget who it was that it's from some famous work. That's kind of what he's saying here. Have I any help in me when resource is driven from me? He who withholds kindness from a friend forsakes the fear of the Almighty. My brothers are treacherous as a torrent's bed, as torrential streams that pass away, which are dark with ice and where the snow hides itself. Just as a by the way, I know some people that have said, well, Job may have been written before the flood, or Job may have lived before the flood at least, but I think verse 16 makes that highly unlikely. Based on what the theories, the working theories behind creation science, the earth would not have had snow before the flood. And in fact, there's also reason from the post-flood world when God speaks to Noah in chapter 9 of Genesis. He says something, and I can't remember where it is. I'll have to find it another time. But there seems to be indications that the seasons, summer, winter, spring, fall, as a system, did not occur until after the flood. And so if Job knows what ice is, or not ice, but at least snow and ice, then probably he's post-flood. Verse 17, when they melt, they disappear. When it is hot, they vanish from their place. The caravans turn aside from their course. They go up into the waste and perish. The caravans of Tema look, the travelers of Sheba, hope. They are ashamed because they were confident. They come there and are disappointed, for you have now become nothing. You see my calamity and are afraid. Have I said, make me a gift? Or from your wealth offer a bribe for me? Or deliver me from the adversary's hand? Or redeem me from the hand of the ruthless? Teach me, and I will be silent. Make me understand how I have gone astray. How forceful are upright words. But what does reproof from you reprove? Do you think that you can reprove words when the speech of a despairing man is wind? You would even cast lots over the fatherless and bargain over your friend. But now, be pleased to look at me, for I will not lie to your face. Please turn. Let no injustice be done. Turn now. My vindication is at stake. Is there any injustice on my tongue? Cannot my palate discern the cause of my calamity? Has not man a hard service on earth? And are not his days like the days of a hired hand? Like a slave who longs for the shadow, and like a hired hand who looks for his wages, so I am allotted months of emptiness, and nights of misery are portioned to me. When I lie down, I say, when shall I arise? But the night is long, and I am full of tossing till the dawn. My flesh is clothed with worms and dirt. My skin hardens, then breaks out afresh. My days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle, come to their end without hope. He's just using this language to describe how awful his existence is, and it does sound terrible. Remember that my life is a breath. My eye will never again see good. He says it's never going to get better. Now we know from the end of the book that that's not true, but that's how he feels in the moment. The eye of him who sees me will behold me no more. While your eyes are on me, I shall be gone. As the cloud fades and vanishes, so he who goes down to Sheol does not come up. He returns no more to his house, nor does his place know him anymore. Therefore, I will not restrain my mouth. I will speak in the anguish of my spirit. I will complain in the bitterness of my soul. Am I the sea or a sea monster that you set a guard over me? When I say, my bed will comfort me, my couch will ease my complaint, then you scare me with dreams and terrify me with visions, so that I would choose strangling and death rather than my bones. I loathe my life. I would not live forever. Leave me alone, for my days are a breath. What is man that you make so much of him, and that you set your heart on him? Visit him every morning and test him every moment. How long will you not look away from me, nor leave me alone till I swallow my spit? If I sin, what do I do to you, you watcher of mankind? Why have you made me your mark? Why have I become a burden to you? Why do you not pardon my transgression and take away my iniquity? For now I shall lie in the earth. You will seek me, but I shall not be. Job is just, he's in a bad, bad way. And he just wishes God would leave him alone. And perhaps you've been there. Now, it's important that we don't read just a little bit of Job. We read all of it. But it's good to know that faithful people of God have been there and done that. And the book of Job is a guide for us when we are feeling like God has it out for us. Psalm 99, the Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. That's what we need a little. We need more trembling in this world. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. The king in his might loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called upon his name. They called to the Lord and he answered them. In the pillar of the cloud, he spoke to them. They kept his testimonies and the statute that he gave them. Something that Samuel has in common with Moses and Aaron is that he actually heard the Lord speak. I think that's why he's included there. O Lord our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain. For the Lord our God is holy. Amen. Now, Revelation chapter 11. Then I was given a measuring rod like a staff, and I was told, rise and measure the temple of God and the altar and those who worship there. Do not measure the court outside the temple. Leave that out, for it is given over to the nations. They will trample the holy city for 42 months. And I will grant authority to my two witnesses. They will prophesy for 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. Now, doesn't that sound a lot like what we read in Ezekiel, chapters 40 through 48, where Ezekiel is told to rise and measure the temple and all these different places in his vision, which was clearly a vision. So it begs the question, is this merely a vision? Here, I know some people think that what John is told to measure is a literal place. And I'm not saying that it's not a real place, but is this vision to be taken literally? And I just don't know the answer to that. Verse 4, these are the two olive trees. What are? Well, the two witnesses here. And the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth. And if anyone would harm them, fire pours from their mouth and consumes their foes. Is God saying that two witnesses in the future are going to literally prophesy for 1,260 days, which is about 3.5 years. In fact, you know, if you take a lunar year, 360 days times 3, that's 1,080, then half of 360, 180, plus the 1,080 is 1,260. So we're talking about 3.5 years here. And are they actually going to have fire come out of their mouth and kill people? There are people that take that exactly literally. I know Tim LaHaye does, the guy that wrote the Left Behind series. And that's what he writes in his book. but I don't know if it's literal or not. Or does that mean they just speak the word and those people die? I don't know. Verse 5, and if anyone would harm them, fire pours from their mouth and consumes their foes. If anyone would harm them, this is how he is doomed to be killed. They have the power to shut the sky, that no rain may fall during the days of their prophesying. I mean, it does seem kind of specific. The more specific a prophecy is, the more literal I tend to take it. And they have power over the waters to turn them into blood, to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they desire. When they have finished their testimony, the beast that rises from the bottomless pit will make war on them and conquer them and kill them. And their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city that symbolically is called Sodom and Egypt, where their Lord was crucified. Well, where was the Lord crucified? Well, Jerusalem. And so Jerusalem is called Sodom and Egypt symbolically here. For 3.5 days, some from the peoples and tribes and languages and nations will gaze at their dead bodies and refuse to let them be placed in a tomb. Those who dwell on the earth will rejoice over them and make merry and exchange presents, because these two prophets had been a torment to those who dwell on the earth. But after 3.5 days, a breath of life from God entered them, and they stood up on their feet, and great fear fell on those who saw them. Who are the two witnesses? There's conjecture. Almost everybody believes one of them is Elijah, and that would make sense. I mean, Elijah was a prophet in the Old Testament, and he never died. Okay, most people that I know that take a futuristic view of this and a literal view of this, think the other prophet is Moses, because he was a prophet of God. I don't take that view. I think it will be Enoch. And of course, it doesn't have to be Elijah and Enoch. It doesn't have to be somebody from the Old Testament. It could just be two people from that day. But it is interesting, isn't it, that the Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die. And far as we know, Elijah and Enoch have not died yet. And these two witnesses are going to die. Enoch was a prophet too. The book of Jude tells us that he prophesied. Verse 11, and great fear fell on those who saw them. They would fear would fall on you too, if you saw a dead body raised. Then they heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, come up here. They went up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies watched them. And at that hour there was a great earthquake, and a tenth of the city fell. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake, and the rest were terrified and gave glory to the God of heaven. The second woe has passed. Behold, the third woe is soon to come. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet. Now there was something about the seventh trumpet in chapter 10. It said when the seventh trumpet, let's go back and look at that. In chapter 10, it says something about the seventh trumpet. The angel who I saw standing on the sea and on the land raised his right hand to heaven and swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heaven and what is in it, the earth and what is in it, the sea and what is in it, that there would be no more delay, but in the days of the trumpet call to be sounded by the seventh angel, the mystery of God would be fulfilled. So, the seventh angel is now blowing his trumpet, which means the mystery of God will be fulfilled. What does that mean? Well, I'm not quite sure. Let's see if we can get a clue. There were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. He shall reign forever and ever. That line is included in the last phrase, in the phrase of Handel's Messiah, which is a beautiful song. The 24 elders who sit on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshiped God, saying, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was. For you have taken your great power and begun to reign. The nations raged, Psalm chapter 2, but your wrath came, the time for the dead to be judged, and for rewarding your servants, the prophets and saints, and those who fear your name, both small and great, and for destroying the destroyers of the earth. Then God's temple in heaven was opened, and the ark of his covenant was seen within his temple. There were flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, and earthquake, and heavy hail. I know this phrase right here, the Ark of His Covenant was seen. is one of the reasons that some people believe that, you know, where's the Ark of the Covenant? Where did it go? Who has it? Some people believe that God snatched it up to heaven. I don't think that this requires that interpretation. There's a lot of things that could be taken metaphorically in this. And there's a lot we don't understand. But I do, you know, but what do we gain from this? After the seventh angel sounds, basically the 24 elders are saying, look, we give thanks to you, God, because your kingdom is coming, and it's coming very soon. And when we combine that with what the angel had said earlier, there will be no more delay. We know that at that point in time, after the two witnesses are killed, the seventh angel blows his trumpet, Jesus' return will be very soon. Which is why it's interesting that the next thing that we see in Revelation chapter 12 is a great sign appears in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, and we'll talk more about that tomorrow, but Revelation cannot be read chronologically. If it were, then the very end would be the next chapter. And the next chapter doesn't occur, I mean, the very end doesn't occur until Revelations 21 and 22. So, the book of Revelation, if you want to confuse yourself, try to read it, try to interpret it chronologically. You can't do that. John, these are visions that reveal different aspects of the future, and they are not necessarily in chronological order. And that's the best way to try to understand the book of Revelation. So that's all the time we have for today. We'll be back here again tomorrow, 10:30, if at all possible. And I hope that you enjoyed today's reading. Hope you gained benefit from it. I hope that you will obey what you read, what you heard. And be a blessing to somebody today. Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Reject sin, obey the Lord, and love other people. God bless you.